Hello all, hope you are doing good. I welcome you all to the 7th lecture in this course EE614. During our previous discussions, we discussed about semiconductor, the carrier density in semiconductor, the thermal equilibrium, the number of electrons and holes, and the effect of Fermi level and so on, right? We also discussed that if we have an electric field E applied to a semiconductor, then the electrons move with a velocity v proportional to the applied electric field, and mu was called as the mobility. And we saw that the mobility depends whether it is for the electron, whether it is for the hole. For the electron, you have what is called the effective mass of an electron, which we described as an geometric mean transpose, right, and so on. Now, this was a situation in which when there is an applied electric field, right? However, when there is no electric field, right? So you have a material, you have a lot of electrons. Let us say that you have a lot of conduction electrons of density n. Right? So you have a lot of electrons randomly oriented, right? Now, do they stay at rest at any non-finite and at any non-zero temperature? Do they stay at rest? The obvious answer to this question is no, right? We all know that the thermal temperature, the thermal energy gives it some kinetic energy. Therefore, we know from the equipartition theorem that if T is the temperature, and if you're talking about only one dimensional electronic transport, then the energy that it has is the kinetic energy is half kBT. This is for one dimension. Of course, if there are three dimensions, if you have a truly cubic solid, then you will have 3/2 kBT, right? This comes from the equipartition theorem. So if we equate this to the kinetic energy of the electron, where Vth is the thermal velocity, we can find that if you put m naught to be equivalent to the rest mass or the free electron mass, you will get Vth somewhere around 10^7 centimeter per second. So basically, it moves at very large velocities, even at room temperature, when there is no applied electric field. So the reason why we do not have any current is that these velocities are randomly oriented, right, such that the net velocity field of all the electrons combined together comes out to be zero, right? That's the reason why we have zero current when there is no external applied electric field. Now let's take an example of this particular box and then draw a fictional line, right? And then we want to see what's the net flux or net number of electrons which move from, say, this is left and this is right, from left to right. What is the net flux of electrons from left to right? For this, we have to define a time constant, right? Because we have to look at it at some time constant. And let us define some characteristic time tau, which is the time between relaxation time or characteristic time constant, which is the time between two collisions, right? And let us say that here we are talking about only one dimensional transport. So basically, an electron which goes from left to right after time tau gets scattered back, right? So this is because there is no in-plane transport. There is only one dimensional transport, so it can either go forward or get scattered back. This is the only two options that the electron has. So when you have something like this, let us say that if tau is the mean lifetime or scattering lifetime, then you have L. We define L as the length that the electron moves in this time tau. In time tau, basically you can relate L as V into tau. Right, so L is the characteristic length, and tau is the characteristic light. Now, with these two given, we can think at any, let us say, in time tau, what's the number of electrons which can go from left to right? That's pretty straightforward, right? So basically, only the electrons which lie within this distance L bar will cross, right? Because any other electron which lies away from this to the left of this particular line will never cross the one that we are trying to solve, and anyone which is inside this have either the possibility to cross the line or go away, right? So basically, and because we are assuming the directions to be random, we will know that the number of electrons which cross this is the actual number of electrons within this particular area divided by 2, because half of them is crossing to the right, half of them is getting scattered back. So the actual flux of left to right, I'm writing it as psi, from left to right is actually n, which is the density of electrons, right, into L bar is the actual length, into W is the width of this guy, right, divided by tau. This is the number of electrons which crosses from left to right in time tau, right? The same thing can be written from right to left, which is n into L bar, this is by 2, right, because only half of the electrons, into W by 2 tau. It's easy to see that if you have, here I write it as nr, this is nl, right, actually the other way around. This is nl and this is nr. So basically, if you have the density of electrons on the left is nl, density of electrons on the right is nr, you can see that the current will be zero. There will be no net flux from left to right or right to left, because both of them will be equal if nl is equal to. Therefore, if nl is equal to nr, you can see that psi left to right is equal to psi right to left. And this is the precise condition for thermal equilibrium when there is no current. Now let us look at a situation where I take the same bar, right, and insert at some point, let us say x is equal to 0, a density of carriers. Now about how I will introduce this is something which is not specific now, because it is not relevant. We will talk about how to introduce excess carriers into a semiconductor later on sometime in our course. But let us say that I have this semiconductor which is neutral initially, and at some point x is equal to 0, I introduce some excess carrier densities n prime which is not equal to n. So you already had some carrier densities, right, and then you introduced additional carriers. So if I draw the density as a function of x, right, so this is the cross-sectional view. I'm just plotting the carrier density as a function of x. I know that at time equal to 0, I have this Dirac delta function. This is n prime, right? At time t equal to t1, this will obviously spread, right? At t equal to t2, which is larger than t1, so this is at t equal to t1. At t equal to t2, which is larger than t1, you will have something like this. This is t equal to t2. At t equal to t3, which is larger than t2, you will get something like this. Eventually, it will all become 0. Right? Now, though this seems pretty intuitive, that this is what you will expect, the reason behind this process, which is called as diffusion, right? The reason behind this is, at any given temperature which is not equal to 0, all the particles in this particular material, right, undergo some random thermal motion with the velocity vth as we described before, right? They all moving in random direction. If the entire material is homogeneous, there will not be any net change. However, you have introduced inhomogeneity at some x is equal to 0. So what happens is, anything at x is equal to 0 will spread out, right? And this random motion which is caused by the thermal energy, will give you a feel as if this guy is trying to diffuse out from this particular point, from this x is equal to 0. Thereby, its carrier density will change like this, right? Now that we understand that this is the carrier density that that will happen, now let us take this particular, let us take at t equal to t2, this plot, right? And then try to understand the carrier dynamics. Now, I'm going to split this x into different lengths, L dash, as we previously saw. And at each point, right, and if L dash is sufficiently small, like how you do for integration, you can assume this line is actually a flat line. And you have n1, n2 at two different time scales, right? Two different length scales, sorry. This is, let's say, x1 and this is x2. Okay, this is x1, the other one is x2. So, in this particular situation, you can easily see that the way normal differentiation is written, dn by dx is actually n2 minus n1 by x2 minus x1, right? And this is x2 minus x1 is L prime, that's what we have seen. And n2 minus n1 by L dash is what dn by dx. Right? Now, let us do the same thing that we have done in this particular space. So, right. So, here, again, as we previously saw, only electrons which are in the distance L bar from x is equal to 0 will move from right to left. Right. And the other guys will not cross this particular line. So, I am again trying to find the net flux of electrons at x is equal to 0. The net flux of electrons at x is equal to 0 is basically, let us say, I right at x is equal to 0 is basically, so this is what is n1, right? It's actually n1. Into L dash is the actual length, into the width, right, by tau. This tau is the relaxation time that we previously defined. N1 into L into W is the actual density of electrons within this particular L dash distance, right? So, with this given, the same thing we can write at x is equal to 0 is actually N2 into L dash, this is actually 2, right, into W by 2 tau. But instead of actually talking about current, we prefer to talk about current density J in the one dimensional limit is just J equal to I by W, right? So, the actual net current density from which goes from left to right is actually N1 minus N2 L dash by 2 tau. Right, L dash N1 minus N2 is what we defined as by 2 tau minus dN by dx, so which is minus dN by dx is actual diffusion current density from right to left, where dN is L by 2 tau. Of course, this is just the flux. The actual current is actually, I made a mistake here. So, this is just the flux. The actual current is E into, right? You have to multiply the electronic charge into minus E. This is minus E. And this is minus E into minus. So, actually, you will get E dN dN by dx. This is the for electrons. The same thing you can define for holes, which will come out to be, right? You can see this is J, right? You can see that if I take a semiconductor, right, and then in one corner, let us say I introduce some electrons, right, and if I introduce some electrons, the electrons diffuse from right to left, right? And when electrons go this way, the actual current goes the other way.
So if we have an inhomogeneous distribution of electrons on one side of the sample, the electrons will diffuse from left to right with decreasing concentration, right, in this particular direction, and hence the actual diffusion current of electrons is opposite to the direction of motion, where it moves in the with a reducing carrier concentration, right? So dN by dx tends to be negative, and then the jN is opposite to the direction of motion of electrons, which is exactly opposite in the case of holes, right? So holes actually moves once again in the direction of decreasing concentration. So as dp by dx is negative, the overall current contribution will become positive, and hence the direction of holes will be along the direction of motion of holes, again replicating the way it happens in the drift, right? Whereas for electrons, the electronic diffusion current is opposite to the direction of its actual motion.
So now that we understand the equations for drift and diffusion current, which is given here, right? Now let us go ahead and then define an important correlation between drift and diffusion, right? To understand this, let us again take the example. Okay, so relationship between drift and diffusion. Now let us take an material, right, and assume that it is not connected to any external circuitry, right? So basically this is open. So if it has no external connections, obviously the current density has to be zero, right? And there is no external applied electric field, right? However, let us say, as we previously described, so let us say that I have introduced some small inhomogeneity, change the carrier density in a very small region. So we know that it undergoes some diffusion, right? So if it undergoes some diffusion, and assume that it is just, I'm introducing only electrons, the actual current is E dN dN by dx, right? But then, however, you can see that it should not have any net current, right? And it cannot have any net potential. So if something like this happens, what the system actually undergoes is that it will add a drift component, right, which is equivalent to minus E n mu n e, right, such that it equals to zero. So here I have a drift current because of the electrons, and here I have a diffusion current as a consequence of homogeneity that I have introduced. So it is this combination of drift and diffusion that the system setups such that it can ensure that there can be no external current and no external potential. So the external potential is from here, from end to end, there cannot be any external potential. Of course, there can be some internal potentials, as long as there is an inhomogeneity that you have introduced artificially. So with this particular condition in place, you can see that I will write E equal to dN by mu n, 1 by n dN by dx, right? If I just rearrange these things. And from my previous lectures, we know that n is equal to number of density in the conduction band and f of EC, right? And you can calculate from this, it is what is dN by dx. Nc is obviously constant, d by dx of f of ec, and if you take in the limit of non-degeneracy, f of ec is actually e power ef minus ec by kbt, right? And if we actually do the differentiation and plug it in, we can see that e will come out to be dn by mu n d e c by dx minus d e f by dx, 1 by kt, right? Now remember, we are in the situation in which there is no current, because we are still talking about open circuit, right? When there is no current, we know the condition, right? The Fermi level should be straight. We previously discussed about this. If there is a net slope in the Fermi level, it introduces current, and which cannot be the case in which we have no external current. So this will be zero, right? And it is easy to see that the change or the slope in the conduction band, the flow, or the valence band for that matter, the slope in the band is equal to the energy or the electric field applied, right? That is, this is what you have previously seen. So let us say this is the band in which there is no applied field, and if I apply an electric field, the band start to tilt such that the slope, this is dE, so this is x, this is E, so dEc by dx is actually equal to the electric field that I have applied, right? In such situation, you know that this is equal to E, right? Therefore, dN by mu n is actually kT. So dN is actually is what we have previously defined. dN is dN is L by 2 tau, right? L bar by 2 tau, which is purely a material parameter. And mu n is once again a material parameter based on how many electrons that you have, and so on and so forth, right? And you can see that this ratio, or the drift and the diffusion constants ratio, depends primarily on the temperature. So with this beautiful equation, we will stop here for now, and the next time we meet, let us talk about little bit of non-equilibrium conditions like recombination and generation. Thank you.